Welcome to Mayo Clinic Sleep Medicine Podcasts, a series for physicians, advanced practice providers, nurses, and other health practitioners treating sleep disorders or interested in learning about state-of-the-art advances in sleep medicine and sleep health. I'm your host, Dr. Michael Silber.
And I'm your co-host, Dr. Maitri Juna. We are both consultants at the Center for Sleep Medicine at the Mayo Clinic in Rochester, Minnesota.
With huge increases in travel across time zones, patients are frequently asking us, how can they reduce jet lag? To discuss the vexed question of sleeping while traveling across time, my guest today is Dr. Robert Auger, Associate Professor of Psychiatry and Medicine and a board-certified sleep specialist at Mayo Clinic in Rochester, Minnesota. Rob, thank you for coming on today. Jet lag seems to be due to the effect of abrupt circadian change with some contributing homeostatic factors related to sleep deprivation. Could you remind our listeners about the length of the intrinsic circadian rhythm and why this makes a difference if one is traveling east or west?
Yeah, sure. Well, thanks for having me. The length of the circadian period on average is greater than 24 hours. So 24.2 hours it's been measured as. And as a result, it's much easier to delay your clock, so to travel westward, than it is to travel eastward, which requires an advancing your sleep onset and wake times.
Okay, so it does make a difference. Let's consider a practical example. You're traveling, you're flying from Minneapolis in the Midwest to Amsterdam, a change of 7 time zones. You're leaving at 4 p.m., and I think the plane generally for a 4 p.m. departure will arrive at about 7 a.m. in Amsterdam. Before we come to what you do in Amsterdam, is there anything you should do prior to the trip to reduce jet lag? And what should your behavior be on the plane?
So I think that in general, it's just observation of good sleep hygiene before one travels, because there's invariably some sleep deprivation that occurs en route. There are a couple of studies that describe preemptive measures for eastward travel, as you described, but it really would require a lot of discipline on the part of the patient. There's protocols that where you advance the sleep schedule gradually, receive light therapy in the morning for up to an hour, take melatonin at a time that would be expected to promote circadian advances. So you're sort of inducing the jet lag in a very graded fashion before one travels. So there are some published studies on that. I think that it requires a lot of discipline. The other thing that it does do is it reduces a risk of what's called antidromic reentrainment, where the clock, as we'll discuss in a second, the clock is more prone to delay because of the lighting cues it will receive upon destination than to advance. And that'll delay the time it takes to acclimate from a circadian standpoint by about 40% or so.
Okay. And on the plane?
On the plane, I would suggest just trying to sleep, if you can, trying to sleep in accordance with the local time zone. But there's so much sleep deprivation that occurs with the uncomfortable seating, environment of the aircraft and the disturbances from other passengers and from the airline staff, that I would recommend just trying to sleep as much as possible. If one is going to take a hypnotic during the flight, I would make sure that you've experimented with said hypnotic before the flight to make sure that you don't have any untoward effects related to its use, and also that you'd be traveling with a companion in case there are some issues with arousals or confusional arousals and so forth.
So let's talk a little bit more about hypnotics. As an expert, do you actually recommend them to patients? And if so, what? I mean, melatonin and what dose, or Zolpidem? What do you tell patients when they ask you that?
I would say that I most commonly actually recommend Zolpidem, but the main reason for that is that the travelers that I see are staying for such a short time at their destination. If you're seeing business travelers, for example, that I think the hopes of circadian acclimation are fairly remote, and that you might be able to instead address jet lag induced insomnia, which is just one of a constellation of symptoms associated with jet lag. There are some studies that compare Zolpidem and melatonin from the standpoint of jet lag induced insomnia and daytime jet lag symptoms. And Zolpidem has actually been shown to be superior in the studies that I'm thinking of, but with much more associated adverse effects and about a 10% dropout rate in the study that I'm thinking of because of adverse effects. So I think I would predominantly recommend Zolpidem, but with the caveat that one experiment with taking the medication before travel to make sure that they tolerate it properly. And I think, as you and I have discussed before, having a companion present when taking a medication like that is important as well.
And if they say they don't want a prescription medication, they want melatonin, what dose would you recommend?
So there actually is a dose-finding study that looks at three different doses, and it turns out if you want to hit the sweet spot between hypnotic properties and chronobiotic or time-adjusting properties, 5 milligrams is the right dose, and you want to give an immediate-release formulation.
Excellent. I've heard from flight attendants that they're most troublesome patients on transatlantic flights are those who've taken Zolpidem and alcohol together, people getting up, trying to open the door and things like that. So I guess that's another precaution, isn't it? Just don't take Ambien with alcohol on the flight.
No, absolutely. There was a study published in JAMA that I think was meant to be humorous, but actually is quite concerning, that described two physicians who were traveling from the States to, I think it was London, and they were taking a benzodiazepine and had no recollection of being in customs or going through customs. And so there's some serious hazards associated with it, potential hazards.
Yes, I warn people about that as well. I don't know how common it is, but these prolonged amnestic reactions, very scary. So your patient has taken off at 4 p.m., has landed at 7 a.m. in Amsterdam. When should that person get sun exposure? And what should they take a nap or not? When should they go to bed? What do you advise them?
So I think that it's very challenging, depending on how much you slept on the flight, to avoid sleeping once you get there. I would limit the sleep bout to about 20 minutes. That way you can avoid some of the sleep inertia that occurs with longer sleep bouts. I would make sure that sleep bout occurred at least several hours, maybe 3 to 4 hours before the destination desired time of sleeping. And as far as if one has knowledge of the light phase response curve, which essentially tells us when light will delay or advance the clock, using those principles, one would want to avoid light during morning hours and seek light during early afternoon hours to promote the phase advance that would be required to acclimate to the new time zone.
Excellent. When I was preparing this, I looked online, and there are a number of calculators for travelers. I put this scenario in and it came up with exactly that answer. I was very pleased to see. Do you think these calculators are accurate?
I think they are good. The one that I use, I tend to do old school pen and paper, but I still use there's a site I use called timeanddate.com, which compares the two time zones depending on where you're traveling from and where you're traveling to, and provides similar recommendations to what you describe.
Excellent. Now your traveler now returns home, traveling now east to west, and obviously that's usually a day flight, isn't it? So, you know, that person will take off somewhere around, I don't know, between 10 a.m. or 12 noon or 2 p.m., travel, and will arrive in the early afternoon or mid-afternoon in Minneapolis generally. What do you advise about light exposure that day or the next day?
So when they return, the time they return, they should be in a relatively neutral zone from the standpoint of light impacting circadian rhythms. But if they adapted to the destination properly, then they'll probably struggle to remain asleep during conventional sleep hours in the home time zone. And so if there's difficulties sleeping during the conventional time zones, you actually would want to be exposed to bright light. That would promote a phase delay, because as you're traveling, returning home on a westward level, you want to delay the clock. So you'd want to receive light during late evening hours and avoid light during early morning hours.
So late evening, but not morning.
Correct. Yep.
Okay.
I suppose late evening could intersect with early morning, very early morning hours, but late evening generally.
Okay, good. Now, you know, the theory's fun. And if you're into circadian rhythms and phase response curves, it's fun to do the maths and calculate the times. What do you think in practice? Does it really matter? If a person says, look, I try adapt to the new time zone, I go to bed at the time of the new time zone, do my best to sleep, and I just try get light whenever I can during the day. Do you think it really makes a difference, this timing?
You know, I think for the casual traveler, it probably doesn't. I think that some of these recommendations, particularly this strategic receipt and avoidance of light, probably do make a difference for high-performing athletes, for people that need to make crucial decisions when they're traveling. I will say that they've only been tested in simulated environments, not field environments. So the definitive answer to that question is unknown. I personally think that, for example, with the light recommendations, that they're easy enough to follow, that I think that they are helpful.
Good, very helpful. Now, again, in preparation for this podcast, I looked on PubMed for recent articles on jet lag, and rather to my surprise, I found almost nothing on the type of jet lag we've been talking about now, but article after article on the phenomenon called social jet lag. Could you tell our listeners what this is? Is it a helpful construct in assessing and managing patients?
I think it is. I think the way I understand social jet lag is that there's such a high prevalence of sleep deprivation or sleep restriction during weekdays that individuals will markedly delay their sleep offset times on weekends, which will make it more difficult to reacclimate to the workday schedule. And there are known health consequences associated with social jet lag, mood disturbances, endocrinologic disturbances. So I think it is a helpful, I think it's really just part and parcel of sleep hygiene. But particularly in younger people, I see marked changes in the sleep schedule on the weekends as compared to the weekdays.
Okay, so it's not sort of a new concept. It's just a word over the last few years given to describe this change between weekdays and weekends.
Exactly.
Well, on weekends, there's both catch-up sleep and also the ability to return to perhaps your own preferred intrinsic circadian rhythm, whereas on weekdays, we're constrained by work schedules and studying schedules, and that's the difficulty in the jet lag shift of social jet lag. That sounds right.
That sounds perfectly right. And, you know, I think the other thing that to think about with this jet lag and social jet lag is that there's this innate trait called phase tolerance. So some people are very much able to sleep at a time that's not synchronous with their underlying circadian rhythms, and that ability seems to vary from individual to individual. It seems to get worse as one gets older. But I think that those are other factors to consider as well.
Good. Very, very helpful. Rob, thank you so much for sharing your expertise. Are there any final messages you would like to leave with our listeners?
I think the only message that I would really want to convey is that that the prospect of treating jet lag, I think, depends really on the individual's goal of travel. If the individual is simply there for pleasure, it may not be crucial to implement all of these measures for jet lag. If you're leaving and you have to give a talk, a presentation, make big decisions, you might want to make more plans to combat jet lag. But I think that it really depends a lot on what the purpose of travel is. That being said, we could also argue that time is precious with travel, but I think that there are guidelines and preparations that one can do, I think, as to whether one follows through with them, or the degree to which one follows through with them really depends upon the goal of travel.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
We hope you enjoyed this podcast. If so, please tune in again through wherever you receive your podcasts as we discuss further topics in sleep medicine and sleep health. Thank you.